Creating and maintaining substation model libraries is a critical part in a successful implementation of a substation solution. And the substation design tools provide a couple of different modules that allow you to both create and publish, as well as share the model libraries. So on the publishing side, within Inventor, we can take any part or assembly file and create an equipment type, give it a description, manufacturing information, catalog number, take a quick snapshot for a thumbnail that we can preview, as well as run some pre-model checks and then upload to the cloud. And the model checking that we're doing here is to make sure that this model is going to be categorized and have useful data for downstream design checking within Inventor. Now on the sharing side, we have a similar tool where the user needs to log in so all the data is secure up on the cloud or within an internal network. You can log in straight out of Inventor and search through the different categories and pull the content down directly from the cloud into the Inventor model. Now let's look at building up a project. And in this demonstration here, we're going to look at building a project from an existing 2D layout. So we can start a brand new empty project, or we can build one from an existing AutoCAD or raster file as the basis for the model. So here we started the project. The main plane on the bottom has this AutoCAD 2D drawing in here, and this can be a legacy drawing, can be a raster file, any kind of information that'll give us some 2D reference points to build up our 3D model on top of. So just separate the UI here in Inventor. I'm going to clean this up so we have both the model cloud library and the local asset library. So anything pulled down from the cloud is also available locally. So for example, here we can browse through and find a model and download it directly from the cloud right into the assembly. All right, so here's an example of a component inside. We'll delete that and let's find something a little more relevant to this station that we're building up here. Let's take some components that we've already downloaded. And things like a truck, for example, to maybe place into the model to check some clearances around structures or cables. Any component could be brought into the model and just snap to the grid. So we don't need to use the 2D reference information here, but we can. So let's look at taking in some posts. We'll put in a foundation and a post. We're going to pick some of the components and some of the highlighted areas. So anything you can pick in 2D is available as a snap point within the 3D model. Okay, so here we're picking the center of the posts from the 2D drawing and it's snapping the model in place. All right, so some very easy pick and place, really stick building up the assembly as we go and using the reference points in the 2D. Now you notice that we only need to do one constraint here basically, it's already fixed to the plane. So all of the assets and components that are created for the substation models themselves, use that core plane. And that plane can be the top of a foundation. All the Z values can be adjusted up and down. But basically to constrain the component, we only need one reference point and we're using the coordinate system constraints. So this makes it very simple to snap together some geometry. And unlike in the past with some 3D systems, you had to have those three constraints. So this makes it very easy to quickly pull together a 3D assembly and you're still using the 2D references that are available from legacy AutoCAD data. So things like foundation, for example, here we're just snapping to a point. That Z value is adjusted already. So within these foundations, there's a dimension from the ground plane up of about 22 inches. So each place we need a foundation, we could snap that in place, pick a rotation angle. And here we're just basically panning around on top of the 2D, pulling in some models, snapping components to them. So there's a lot of intelligent components made up there. There's some work points and coordinate system references. Make it very easy to quickly build up that assembly. Let's look at building a brand new station. So opening up Inventor, I'm going to log into the model cloud so our component library is available to us. And then we're going to start a brand new station. We're not going to build anything out of any AutoCAD 2D or any kind of 3D reference points. We're going to start a brand new station from scratch. And really this allows us to open up the grid and other greenfield project or doing a quick quotation here. We can pull in some components and quickly do a study or something like that. So here we're pulling some disconnect switches. I'm going to snap it to the grid, pick a rotation angle. Let's turn off some work points here so we can see what's going on. And then we'll go into the cloud. We're going to go to our circuit breakers, and we're going to download this circuit breaker straight off the cloud and pull it right into the Inventor assembly, snap it in place. And of course, we can do a rotation or pick and movement. So this is really very similar to the AutoCAD workflow of putting in blocks, because that ground plane is already chosen. It's going to snap to that. So you really just need to locate in the X and Y. Let's put in some bare cable. So now that we have some models in place, really all we need to do is put some fittings on that we can attach some bare cable to. So if we go to the top in our substation menu, the above grade tools there, we'll see some bare fittings, cable fittings that we can put into place. So here we're just picking some surface information. We don't need to predefine anything in those parts. A lot of these files come in as step files directly from vendors. We'll just drop those in place and we'll snap some fittings to it. Now the disconnect switch in this case already had some fittings. We just placed some fittings on the breaker. And really to run some bare cable now, we use our pick two fittings cable feature inside the substation tool. And it's going to automatically create the 3D spline of the cable, calculating the best values it can for sag. So as you can see in 3D, this eliminates a lot of different picks and clicks that you'd have to do just within the 3D modeling tool itself. So here the program is calculating all values to constrain the spline, generate the spline along that sag, and also using the size of the cable to kind of come up with that form for the 3D spline. Now also important, as we move components around, as we're tweaking the design in the X, Y, and Z values, so we can move the components around in space, and we can update our cable at any time. So after the initial join of two fittings to a cable, we're able to quickly go through and update any movement, and it'll relocate and reattach the cables correctly. Now leveraging the Autodesk suites now, so the product suites allow us to do a lot of interactivity between AutoCAD and Inventor, so really pulling together the 2D, 3D worlds. So within Inventor, we're able to synchronize with AutoCAD. It'll automatically generate a drawing right across the plan view of all the projected surfaces and lines for each model, generate the drawing, and open it in AutoCAD to be used. So all of the assets, all of the library components that we created, when you publish the asset, we're automatically creating a 3D and a 2D. So there's a 2D block reference and a 3D reference for each component of the library. So as you can see here, we're just using the same asset names, exactly the same structure in the asset views. But here we're dragging and dropping them in AutoCAD in 2D and basically building our layout. And now we're going to synchronize with Inventor. I'm going to save the file. And it's going to go back to Inventor and automatically update and generate all of the 3D models based off of that 2D geometry. So again, being able to leverage the AutoCAD legacy data and training, so the people that are very familiar with AutoCAD can quickly go through here and move back and forth between the 3D and the 2D. So a lot of times doing AutoCAD 2D layouts and then moving back to the 3D to run cables, check sag and design check clearances, and then back to AutoCAD to kind of complete the drafting process of the station itself. And of course, we can turn off that 2D within Inventor. So here we're turning off the sketch. So we can suppress that sketch. You'll see the blue lines on the bottom. So that suppresses the drawing, makes it a lot clearer to work on the 3D. For trench and conduit, we have a couple of different tools that really assist the designer in laying in trench, adjusting components, and running conduit from equipment down to the trench. So in this example here, we're going to use our trench tools, and we're going to add a couple of different components to our trench run. So this can either be sketched in 2D and automatically generated in 3D, or here we're, in this case, we're working in 3D, choosing some points and adding some components to the trench run. So here we can add a cross type trench, run some conduit outside across the X and in front. So we'll bring that straight up a little closer to that breaker. So we can build up a conduit run by starting with a PVC insert on the equipment, using the elbows and conduit sizes and offsets, as well as different straight lengths and adjustments to build up the conduit run manually. But we also have an auto route feature that can end with a 90 degree bend or a 45. So let's use that, pick this cabinet, pick the bottom face, I'm going to pick a conduit size, and then we're going to pick the trench component that we'd like to run to. So we can pick any trench component we'd like. Let's pick the closest one here, and it's going to automatically generate a conduit run using different parts. So it really is each individual part made up, and it would be in a bill of material complete. So it runs that conduit down and automatically calculates the bend values. So let's continue on a little bit more here. We'll put some more trench components in, get a little closer to that other circuit breaker. So we'll add a couple more straights, and let's do another conduit run from the other breaker. So again, we're reducing the amount of picks and clicks. If you were to do this manually in any 3D system, you'd have to constrain each component, place the parts in space, orient them correctly, as well as add some of the attributes that we're using downstream to do some design checking. So now that we've got a conduit run and a trench set up, let's take a look at some of the intelligence that it's embedded in some of these components. So for example, now we can do a system check, get a total length, so a from to, directly from the equipment down the conduit up the trench to the house. And we can check each path of the equipment as well as the percent of conduit fill. So because we know the electrical information of the equipment and where the control house is, the trench components that each conduit piece is touching, we get a true from to. We have several grounding tools available as well. So inside the substation design tools, we can generate both a ground grid as well as connect each piece of equipment with grounding rods and lugs. So up on our tools here, we're going to see the generate ground grid. It takes a best guess estimate at the size of the overall grid and then a spacing in between. So we fill in these numbers, select done, and it's going to generate the grid. You can see the rods across the bottom of the station here. Let's zoom into a piece of equipment here. We'll go down on the disconnect switch and let's put in a ground lead from the equipment over to a ground rod. So again, we'll go to our substation menu and we'll create an equal length ground lead. Let's select any piece of equipment and it'll find the closest location to put a ground lug. And we're going to put a tap flange on any piece of rod. So here we're just selecting along the rod any location we'd like. And we can drag that tap lug along the rod as well. So once those two components are in place, we just need to run the lead directly from the lug. So in this case, the lug is turned the opposite way. So we're going to pick flip lug direction. It's going to turn it around so it's facing away from the equipment. So there's small adjustments that need to be done on each piece of equipment depending on the orientation within the model. So now let's start a run. So we're going to do this ground lead. It's going to show us three axes, different colors, and it's going to automatically generate that ground lead. So again, the substation tools are taking care of the generation of that 3D spline, and it's creating a true part file. So that's in the bill of material. We can gather up all the lengths, the real lengths calculated into a bill of material, as well as the lugs and the taps. So every time one of these is added, it's a true bill of material quantity being added to the overall model. The substation design lightning checks gives us the ability to lay in some lightning posts. So we put in the masts at any location we'd like. Again, we're just picking and placing these components within the grid so we can snap them to a location or we can place them anywhere we'd like on that plane. So we'll place in a couple of masts. Here we're just putting four around the outside of the station. We're not going to do the complete overall lightning layout. So with a couple of masts in place, we could add some shield wire across the top of the mast. So again, we're just picking some work points, and the substation tools are taking care of generating the actual 3D spline that represents the cable component itself. So let's add another shield wire across the two masts in the back. And again, it's important that the substation tools are calculated on the sag based on the size of the shield wire. And when we run the cones, you'll see how the cones react to that sag. So it truly is taking a representation of both the slope as well as the way the mast angles are touching the ground. So here we're just adjusting the size of the shield wire. We can edit any one of the shield wires here, pick a different wire size, as well as if we have a calculation for the sag, we can either use the sag or the tension to kind of calculate that sag percentage. So again, we're going to edit this shield wire, change the size of the wire, and the sag is automatically recalculated for the value of that size wire. So with the shield wires in place now, we can show cone protection. So this is creating true inventor volumes, which can be used to do a subtraction of the interfering parts, what's inside and outside that envelope, but also gives you a visual representation very quickly that you can walk through and move around the model to see if anything's touching. So it's both a cone protection type and a rolling sphere method, which is just the IEEE method for calculating the rolling sphere along those shield wires. Now, the design checking that can be done in the substation design tools pulls together all of that information inside the intelligent library. So both the components as well as the cables, conduit, trench, all the different pieces come together here for the design checking. So this is where all the work really pays off in the model. So now we're able to go through and step through, you know, ABC phases. We can look at selected ground structures, ground equipment, and do things like phase-to-phase clearance checking. So preset values are defined in the setup of the substation tools. And now the design check will go through and look at required separation values, find out if anything is interfering, basically if there's any rules breaking those values. Now let me just orient the model around here and we'll get a look at, really look at the breaker and some of the insulators, and we'll see some of the intelligence in the library itself. So now we're going to go back and run a phase to ground clearance check. And now to run this, we know what the live cables and fittings are, but you keep an eye on that breaker, you're going to see the insulators kind of flash on and off. And this is using the volumes of the model, removing the features, and doing a true ground clearance check. There's several other checks. You can toggle the clearance checks on and off. So basically remove those volumes, check out the models, kind of step through each one of the components with that off. As well as some of the other clearance values. Now, as we mentioned earlier, the bill of material is complete on the entire station. So each time we're adding a bare cable, the fittings are automatically calculated, added to the bill of material, the conduit components, each piece of equipment, the structures themselves, everything is completed in that bill of material. And it can be exported to either Excel, XML, or a text file to be used downstream by another system. Now in the all-important drawing phase, we're leveraging all of the data that's put into the model, all of the component information, and just pure native Inventor generate the drawing set. So on given any drawing, we can generate a base view, select the assembly that we'd like to use for the base view, and it quickly generates, you know, top, front, side, sectional views on the drawing. And everything is fully dimensional. It's all to scale. The full model is represented. We can turn off on and off different components to have a true representation similar to the legacy 2D drawings that might have been available, as well as just picking and dragging and dropping new annotations on the model. So an example of a subset drawing, it would create just a high side. So we can create a base view and select the assembly we'd like to use. So it doesn't need to be the top level assembly. It can be any sub-assembly. So here we'll pick a high side. And we'll enter a scale value so the view fits within the drawing sheet. And we'll place that view right in the middle of the drawing for now. So that view is automatically created. We can move that around. If you zoom in here, you can see the information and the detail. Again, it's all to scale, so annotations are simply just pick and place. So we can project the dimensions from the model itself onto the view. And we can create other views. So here we're creating a simple projected view. It's automatically generated. It's an exact replication of the model view. And we can continue to put our dimensions on. Of course, all the dimensioning can be formatted similar to the drafting standards you might have in place today. But very simple to go through and quickly, you know, generate a full set of drawings. Now, it's important to note that you can go right down to the detailed level of a structure, for example. So here we're picking just a structured part. We're creating a drawing for it, again, three views, and we can dimension this part file. But more importantly, it can be taken by an engineering firm, and they can use that part file and separate it into separate components, replace it with true wide flange beams, separate plate, get all the details of the holes, everything in there, and have a reference back to that top-level assembly. We've seen that the substation design solution helps bridge that gap between native Inventor and the needs of substation designers. We've seen how you can publish, share, and leverage existing substation content directly from the cloud right inside of Inventor. We've seen how easy it was to attach simple cable fittings to existing vendor models, even in step file format, and then pick those fittings to apply a bare cable and have it automatically calculate the sag values. We've seen how easy it is to put shield wire and mast together to do lightning protection checks, and how easy it is to auto-route conduit to trench, generate ground grids, and grounding leads. And finally, we reviewed the design checks, which really ties it all together and helps the designers make critical decisions to save time. Thank you.